Welcome everybody to Biblical Resources. This is a short presentation on John chapter 10 verses 1 to 10, the gospel for the fourth Sunday of Eastertide. As always, I will use slides to guide us through the reflection, so I'll turn on the slides now straight away. So welcome to John 10, 1 to 10. The steps we'll follow are the current context of faith, a brief note on the lectionary and Eastertide, a reading of John 10, 1 to 10 in its wider context, the background to the reading, the context in the fourth gospel, commentary, more or less verse by verse, and then a brief interlude, Visio Divina, with some music to lead us into a closing prayer. So the current context, it seems to me, is threefold. There is present always at the moment the current context of the coronavirus and the voice of faith during the pandemic, sometimes very strong, sometimes very light. Always interesting to ask, How are we being helped by our leaders in the faith? Of course, the current context always includes CSA, the permanent harm, of course, to the victims, also to the faith community, and as we know from recent news, the constant aftershocks that will go on for a long time. And there's also today a question which touches on John 10, 1 to 10, the question of the future leadership in the faith community. Who will be there? A real question for everyone. We may also ask, what may we expect from a faith leader? And it seems to me we can expect a number of things, all I hope not unreasonable. A person of faith and prayer, a person who cares for people, especially people for whom that person is responsible. A person who can name the times in which we live and to help us to understand what's happening in our real world. A person who can speak the faith in new and evolving contexts. And finally, a person with some skills in administration and management. I put the fifth. It seems to me to be the least important because skills in administration and management can be had by buying them or by having training in them. And the first four, to me, are the more important dimensions of faith leadership that we have a right to expect. A word about the lectionary in Eastertide. I would like to concentrate on the Gospels over on the right. As you know, we are in the year of Matthew. Nevertheless, as you can see, John's gospel is privileged during the Easter season because he has no year of his own. Nevertheless, it was interrupted by the story of the disciples on the road to Emmaus. From now on until Ascension and Pentecost, we hear from the gospel of John. So next Sunday, John 10, 1 to 10. I'm going to read the passage in its longer version. So starting from chapter 9, verse 40, and closing with chapter 10, verses 19 to 21. Because as we'll see as the presentation unfolds, it's important to get that context right in John's gospel. Some of the disciples who were with him heard this and asked him, "We are not blind too, are we?" And Jesus replied, "If you were blind, you would not be guilty of sin. But now because you claim that you can see, your guilt remains. I tell you the solemn truth, the one who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs in some other way, is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. The doorkeeper opens the door for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought all his sheep out, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they recognize his voice. They will never follow a stranger, but will run away from him because they do not recognize the stranger's voice. Jesus told them this parable, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So Jesus said to them again, I tell you the solemn truth. I am the door for the sheep. All who came before me were thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters through me, he will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come so that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. A hired hand, who is not a shepherd and does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and abandons the sheep and runs away. So the wolf attacks the sheep and scatters them. Because he is a hired hand and is not concerned about the sheep, he runs away. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not come from this sheepfold. I must bring them too, and they will listen to my voice, so that there will be one flock and one shepherd. This is why the Father loves me, because I lay down my life, so that I may take it back again. No one takes it away from me, but I lay it down of my own free will. I have the authority to lay it down, and I have the authority to take it back again. This commandment I received from my Father. Another sharp division took place among the Jewish people because of these words. Many of them were saying, He is possessed by a demon and has lost his mind. Why do you listen to him? Others said, These are not the words of someone possessed by a demon. A demon cannot cause the blind to see, can it? A brief word about how to read the fourth gospel. Almost every passage in the fourth gospel exhibits the following features. The writing is always in dialogue with the Jewish scriptures, what we call the Old Testament. The text is very often in dialogue with themes from the Jesus tradition as preserved in the synoptic gospels. The context of the time of writing always plays a role, and we shall see that the Good Shepherd discourse does reflect issues at the time of writing. And finally, the metaphors and images in John can be read across the whole gospel. A very obvious one, for instance, is the image of water throughout the gospel. In our passage, the image life and the expression I am can be traced throughout the gospel, very significantly and richly. A brief note on the background from the Old Testament, the Jewish scriptures. There is a general Near Eastern background in which the image of a shepherd is used for rulers in general and also for God. And over on the right-hand side of the screen, you see the Assyrian ruler, the marvelous name Shalmaneser III, holding the staff of office, that he is a shepherd of his people. Of course, everyone remembers Psalm 23, the Lord's my shepherd, and it is actually very significant that David was a shepherd before he was called. You remember the passage in 1 Samuel 16, 11 to 13, which I'll read. So Jesse had him brought in, David. Now he was ruddy, with attractive eyes and a handsome appearance. The Lord said, "Go and anoint him. This is the one." So Samuel took the horn full of olive oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. The Spirit of the Lord rushed upon David from that day forward. There are many passages from the Old Testament using shepherd language, none perhaps more significant than Ezekiel 34. And although the passage is long, I think I might read it to get the force of it, because this is a key for understanding John chapter 10. It's a judgment on the behavior of the shepherds. "The Lord's message came to me, 'Son of man, prophesy against the shepherds of Israel. Prophesy and say to them, to the shepherds, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Woe to the shepherds of Israel who have been feeding themselves. Should not shepherds feed the flock? You eat the fat, you clothe yourselves with the wool, you slaughter the choice animals, but you do not feed the sheep. You have not strengthened the weak, healed the sick, bandaged the injured, brought back the strays, or sought the lost, but with force and harshness you have ruled over them. They were scattered because they had no shepherd, and they became food for every wild beast. My sheep wandered over all the mountains and on every hill. My sheep were scattered over the entire face of the earth, with no one looking or searching for them. Therefore, you shepherds, listen to the Lord's message. As surely as I live, declares the sovereign Lord, my sheep have become prey and have become food for all the wild beasts. There was no shepherd, and my shepherds did not search for my flock, but fed themselves and did not feed my sheep. Therefore, you shepherds, listen to the Lord's message. This is what the sovereign Lord says. Look, I am against the shepherds, and I will demand my sheep from their hand. I will no longer let them be shepherds. The shepherds will not feed themselves anymore. I will rescue my sheep from their mouths, so that they will no longer be food for them. For this is what the sovereign Lord says. Look, I myself will search for my sheep and seek them out. As a shepherd seeks out his flock when he is among his scattered sheep, so I will seek out my flock. I will rescue them from all the places where they have been scattered on a cloudy, dark day. I will bring them out from among the peoples and gather them from foreign countries. I will bring them to their own land. I will feed them on the mountains of Israel, by the streams and all the inhabited places of the land. In a good pasture I will feed them, and the mountain heights of Israel will be their pasture. There they will lie down in lush pasture, and they will feed on rich grass on the mountains of Israel. I myself will feed my sheep, and I myself will make them lie down, declares the sovereign Lord. I will seek the lost and bring back the strays. I will bandage the injured and strengthen the sick. For the fat and the strong I will destroy. I will feed them with judgment." Written, as you remember, during the exile in Babylon, when the leadership had failed, and Ezekiel does not hesitate to name who was responsible and what the Lord's reaction to their failure is. There are, of course, more attractive images. I'll read a number of them. From the prophet Micah, "I will certainly gather all of you, O Jacob. I will certainly assemble those Israelites who remain. I will bring them together like sheep in a fold, like a flock in the middle of a pasture. They will be so numerous that they will make a lot of noise." Or Jeremiah, "They will come and shout for joy on Mount Zion. They will be radiant with joy over the good things the Lord provides, the grain, the fresh wine, the olive oil, the young sheep, and the calves he has given to them. They will be like a well-watered garden and will not grow faint or weary anymore." Or very famously from Isaiah 40, "Like a shepherd he tends his flock. He gathers up the lambs with his arm. He carries them close to his heart. He leads the ewes along. There's also an extensive New Testament background, and I won't go into all the detail here. At your leisure, you can look up the various references. Very quickly, there are many citations. For instance, in Matthew 2:6, it talks about a coming Savior who will shepherd my people Israel. Or in the birth stories in Luke, the shepherds appear, Luke chapter 2, as you can see the various references. The care of Jesus is captured. They were like sheep without a shepherd. The mission is also captured in Matthew. I'm sending you out like sheep among wolves. And then there are false prophets, wolves in sheep's clothing. Most memorably, of course, we have the parable of the lost sheep. And I might read both of these. It's the same parable, but you can see, in two very different contexts. So Luke 15 first. Now all the tax collectors and sinners were coming to hear him, but the Pharisees and the experts in the law were complaining, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." So Jesus told them this parable. "Which one of you, if he has 100 sheep and loses one of them, would not leave the 99 in the open pasture and go look for the one that is lost until he finds it? Then when he has found it, he places it on his shoulders, rejoicing. Returning home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, telling them, 'Rejoice with me, because I have found my sheep that was lost.' I tell you, in the same way, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous people who have no need to repent." The setting in Matthew is fairly different. "See that you do not disdain one of these little ones, for I tell you that their angels in heaven always see the face of my Father in heaven. What do you think? If someone owns 100 sheep and one of them goes astray, will he not leave the 99 on the mountains and go look for the one that went astray? And if he finds it, I tell you the truth, he will rejoice more over it than over the 99 that did not go astray. In the same way, your Father in heaven is not willing that one of these little ones be lost." The Matthew version is a closer background, perhaps, for the John discourse on the Good Shepherd. What about the context in the fourth gospel? Well, we need to make three steps. In the gospel as a whole, under the rubric of the Jewish feast, we'll see that in a moment. And one of those feasts is the Feast of Sukkoth, which takes up John 7:1 to 10:21. And within that, you have John 9:1 to 10:21, the story of the man born blind, followed by the closely linked discourse of the Good Shepherd. So we'll go first to the gospel as a whole. I hope this isn't too scary. Looking at the top row, we notice that in the Gospel of John, you have a prologue, part one, the Book of Signs, part two, the Book of Glory, and an epilogue, chapter 21, at the end. Within the Book of Signs, there are four large moments. There are call stories in chapter 1, 19 to 51. There is what we may call a nuptial sequence using the symbolism of marriage in chapters 2 to 4. There's a sequence of significant Jewish feasts in chapters 5 to 10. And then lastly, you have the story of Lazarus, chapters 11 and 12. Within the sequence of the feasts, you have four feasts. You have Sabbath in John 5, which just might be Pentecost, Passover in John 6, the Feast of Sukkoth, the Feast of Tabernacles or Tents in John 7:1 to 10:21, and then a much briefer one in John 10:22 to 42, the more recent feast of Hanukkah. What happens in those sections is the writer of the Gospel explores the identity of Jesus using the traditional symbolism associated with each feast. For example, the feast of Sukkot celebrated the time in the desert. And the symbolism of Sukkot was water, so the water from the rock, the light, so the light that went, the flame that went before them by night, the temple, and the living in tents. And if you look at the map over on the right, at the very bottom, more or less in the center, there's the pool of Siloam, and water was brought from the pool of Siloam up to the temple. And the water was poured over the altar, and the altar was struck with branches. This is recalling Moses striking the rock in the desert. The pool of Siloam, of course, still exists and can be visited. There's part of it exposed in the old city of Jerusalem. Traditionally, the feast was celebrated with tremendous joy and candelabra. And here's an artist's impression of what the temple may have looked like for the Feast of Sukkot with the famous two giant candelabra. So we just take a quick glance then. John chapter 7 verse 1 to 10 verse 21 is all under the rubric of the Feast of Sukkot. And the Feast of Sukkot proper is in 7 to 9. We have the symbolism of water and light, and I am the light of the world. Within that, you have the story of the man born blind, where I am the light of the world is repeated, and there's an immense struggle with the Pharisees. And finally, then, you have the Good Shepherd discourse, 10:1 to 21, which is effectively judgment on the Pharisees. And as you will have noticed when I read the fuller extent, there's a frame. So John 9:40 and John 10:21 frame the story in really significantly. I just repeat those two verses to make it clear. John 9:40, some of the Pharisees who were with him heard this and asked him, "We are not blind too, are we?" And John 10:21, a demon cannot cause the blind to see, can it? So the blindness and the reaction to the curing the blind man remains the context for all of the discourse in John 10:1 to 21, including our shorter section, 10:1 to 10, the Sunday Gospel. To make it super clear, in John 9:1 to 41, the leadership has failed in its duty. They harassed and abused the man born blind and his family and neighbors. Eventually, they threw him out of the synagogue. That expression occurs in the telling. And by these actions, they have revealed themselves as truly blind. And when they ask, "We're not blind, are we?" of course, they speak the truth about themselves. And in response, in John 10:1 to 21, Jesus contrasts himself with other false shepherds. As light of the world, celebrating the Feast of Sukkot, Jesus overcame the man's darkness. Within that story, Jesus sought him out, went looking for him, twice in the story. And finally, Jesus led him to the community flock of faith in Jesus, the Good Shepherd. So that remains the context for the discourse. The passage refers to the Pharisees. Now, it's just noticeable that in the time after the destruction of Jerusalem, many of the parties familiar from the Synoptic Gospels no longer existed, such as the Sadducees. However, John's Gospel does talk about priests and Levites. It does not talk about Sadducees ever, or doesn't use the expression scribes, but Pharisees are very much present. It's important to say that the Pharisees in John's Gospel are not the historical figures of controversy familiar from the Synoptics, but the contemporary Jewish leadership at the time of writing, the so-called synagogue across the road. The typical synoptic concerns are missing: purity regulations and dietary laws. Instead, the constant issue is the identity of Jesus in the developed understanding of the Johannine community. So we're not true so much to pay attention to the Pharisees as they had been during the ministry of Jesus, but rather the living opponents of the Johannine community at the time of writing. Another note, in John's Gospel, the expression "I am" is extremely significant, and you can see there from the number of passages, we won't read them all, that it occurs very, very frequently. It's really all connected with Exodus 3:14. God said to Moses, "I am who I am." And he said, "Say this to the people of Israel, I am has sent me to you." And you can see in other passages how the same expression recurs. And within the gospel itself, Jesus occasionally simply says, "I am." I look at two examples and leave the rest for your own perusal. To the Samaritan woman at Jacob's well near the town of Sychar, Jesus said to her, "I who speak to you am." So the expression there is "I am." In English we need "he" at the end, but in Greek you don't. To the disciples in the boat while Jesus is walking on the Sea of Galilee, he said to them, "It is I," which is literally in Greek, "I am," again, the name of God. And so it occurs across the other texts as well. You will remember, of course, that there are seven great "I am" sentences in the fourth gospel, which have a tremendous effect. And it's not accidental that there are seven. So I'll call out the main titles without going into every detail that you can see. To the crowds in Galilee, after the feeding of the 5,000, Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life." To the Jews in Jerusalem at the Feast of Tabernacles, again, Jesus spoke to them saying, "I am the light of the world," echoing the symbolism of light for the Feast of Tabernacles or the Feast of Sukkoth. To the Jews just after Jesus gives sight to the man born blind, Jesus says, "I am the door of the sheep." And then further on in 10:11, "I am the good shepherd." To Martha of Bethany, just before Jesus raises her brother back to life, Jesus says, "I am the resurrection and the life." And then in the last meal together, the Last Supper discourse, we read in chapter 14, Jesus said, "I am the way and the truth and the life." And finally, in chapter 15, "I am the true vine." That's your context for these important statements. It means that Jesus' self-identification in the Gospel of John echoes God's naming of himself at the burning bush, "I am who I am," reflecting the deep theology of the fourth gospel. The images used, so bread of life, light of the world, good shepherd, resurrection, way, truth, and vine vineyard, as you can see there from the references, all have extremely strong Old Testament resonances and backgrounds. The one missing one is the door, but the other ones are all powerful, as you can see. And the first hearers of the gospel would have picked up these resonances without difficulty. We have to go searching in our Bible footnotes and so on. So, to a commentary. John chapter 10, verse 1. "I tell you the solemn truth. The one who does not enter by the sheepfold, by the door, but climbs in some other way, is a thief and a robber. And the one who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep." So this verse begins with, "Amen, amen," translated here as, "I tell you the solemn truth." The warning is immediately against false teachers who don't come in by the gate, the authentic point of entry, that is, through faith in Jesus. We are to imagine a robber scrambling over a fence to steal the sheep while they are in their pens. Probably we are to think of the opponents of Jesus during his ministry, and the opponents of the Johannine community at the time of writing. Both, in the view of this community, have failed the flock of Israel. The authentic shepherd does not enter by other means. Later, Jesus compares himself not as expected with the shepherd, but with the door. So the imagery is unfolded without regard for strict linear logic. Verses 3 and 4. The doorkeeper opens the door for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought them all his sheep out, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they recognize his voice. We are to imagine it is early morning and the sheep are let out to graze. And these are images of trust. He is recognized by the gatekeeper and by the sheep. People who keep animals do know them individually, even if not literally, by name. And there's a helpful verse from Psalm 80. O shepherd of Israel, pay attention, you who lead Joseph like a flock of sheep. And there's a marvellous moment in the trial in front of Pilate, only in John's Gospel, at 18:37. Pilate asked him, so you are a king? And Jesus answered, you say that I am a king. For this I was born, for this I came into the world, to testify the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice. Verse 5, they will never follow a stranger, but will run away from him because they do not recognize the stranger's voice. That is to say, the believers will not entrust themselves to unknown leaders. That's a little bit in contrast with what we read in John 1:11. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. And that notion of his own has further echo in the gospel. Later on in chapter 10, we read, I am the good shepherd, I know my own, and my own know me. And then very significantly, at the beginning of the final Passover in this gospel, we read, now before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The verb to follow was established earlier as a key expression for discipleship in the first chapter of John. Verse 6. Jesus told them this parable, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. This little story is called a parable, literally a paroimia, not the usual word for a parable. And the word occurs later in John 16. I have said these things to you in figures of speech. The hour is coming when I will no longer speak to you in figures, but will tell you plainly of the Father. And such a figure of speech is hidden and requires interpretation. Not for the first time in this gospel, Jesus is not understood. In reality, the writer makes use of such misunderstanding to emphasize and to deepen his teaching. John chapter 10, verse 7. So Jesus said again, I tell you the solemn truth, I am the door for the sheep. So a new start is made with a second use of amen, amen. The metaphorical language has taken an unexpected twist because earlier we had a doorkeeper and a shepherd, but now Jesus claims to be the door. This identification of Jesus as the point of entry in his person is entirely in harmony with this gospel. Could we read elsewhere in John chapter 6, 28 to 29? So then they said to him, what must we do to accomplish the deeds God requires? And Jesus replied, this is the deed God requires, to believe in the one whom he has sent. And later in John 17:3, we read, now this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. So every single story in this gospel focuses on the identity of Jesus. And in fact, the proclamation is not the message of Jesus, but the message about Jesus himself. Verse 8. All who came before me were thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. This is a rather sweeping statement. It can't mean all previous religious leadership in Israel. That would be too sweeping a claim and would include Abraham, Moses, David, and so on. It is much more likely that immediate opponents at the time of writing are in view and are here. They stand condemned, more or less in the language of Ezekiel. There might also be an allusion to nationalist leaders, that is, bandits, robbers to the Romans, who sometimes use the language of Messiah to lend authority to their revolts, fresh in people's minds after the Jewish War in 67 to 70 AD, a catastrophic event in the life of the Jewish people. Verse 9, I am the door. If anyone enters through me, he will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. To save is an infrequent but important verb in the first half of this gospel only. So it pops up in John 3, 5, 10, 11 and 12. You will remember the important verse in John 3, 17. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world should be saved through him. Or John 12, 47. For I have not come to judge the world, but to save the world. And the pastoral imagery is developed here to illustrate what is meant by saving. They will come in and go out and find pasture. Kind of echo of Ezekiel 34 and probably as well Psalm 23. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come so they may have life and may have it abundantly. So tremendous contrast here between the thief, the inauthentic leader, and the genuine leader, which is Jesus, leading to one of the great sentences of this gospel. I have come so they may have life and may have it abundantly. And I put there a very complete picture of the occurrence of the word life in this gospel. So it's practically in every chapter, as you can see. And it occurs in the prologue. And famously, it concludes the gospel in chapter 20, the first conclusion, where we read, Now Jesus performed many other miraculous signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not recorded in this book, but these are recorded so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. So just to recap a tiny bit, when reading John's Gospel, always in dialogue with the Jewish scriptures, what we call the Old Testament, Ezekiel in particular, with his sharp condemnation of the shepherds. Almost always in dialogue with the Jesus tradition, so the pastoral images, and of course the parable of the lost sheep. The context of the time of writing is extremely important here. The blindness of the contemporary Jewish leadership to the true identity of Jesus. They failed to recognize the light of the world, the gate, and the good shepherd. And as we just saw, certain images and certain expressions can be read right across the gospel, and there are two fine examples in this, the expression I am and the word life. So we're fully permitted to read into, in a particular chapter, the occurrence of these expressions elsewhere in the Gospel of John. So to go back to our current context, I asked at the beginning, what may we responsibly expect from a faith leader? And I listed the following things, a person of faith and prayer, a person who cares for people genuinely, a person who can help us name the times in which we live, a person who can speak the faith in new and evolving context, and a person with some skills in administration and management. And as the John chapter 10 is really against failed leadership, then it invites us to reflect on what is good leadership in the Christian community. It also invites us who are not in leadership to ask ourselves, who should we be? So that faith leaders can fulfill their call to serve. I would list the following characteristics. We too have to be people of faith and prayer. We should be people who critically support those who serve us in leadership. And both words are important. Support, of course, but critically. That's to say, helpfully. Naturally, we cannot outsource the discernment of the times. We also have to have our own discernment and capacity to name the times in which we live. And we also have to be able to speak the faith into new and evolving contexts. We can't simply outsource that either. And finally, we should be people who make our own gifts available for the good of all and not simply leave it up to the leadership. To take us into a moment of prayer, I'm going to use some images of the Good Shepherd and play a short 3-minute piece of music. So I invite you to a different moment after all the analysis to be open then to prayer as we close this reflection together. So we pray. O God, you never cease to call even those far away, for it is your will that all be drawn into one fold. Attune our ears to the voice of the Good Shepherd, who leads us always to you, that we may find under your tender protection life in all its fullness. We ask this through Jesus Christ, the resurrection and the life, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen. I'm going to close down the slides now.
So thank you very much for taking part in this reflection on John chapter 10, verses 1 to 10. I hope it has helped you to prepare for the next Sunday's gospel. Thank you very much, everybody.